This morning, in the message that I present, I'm going to share a story that some of you may have heard me share before. But you know, sometimes there are times in our life, there are events in our life that are really profound that serve as a vehicle for an important biblical teaching. So I share a story with you today in my message that some of you may have heard me share before. I trust that as you listen to it, you will use that God's Spirit will connect the dots for you and draw us all closer to Him. Let's pray. Loving Lord, as we enter now into this time of teaching, we are here to receive Your Word. It's not the teaching that I can give, but it's the teaching that You want to give us. So open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds and our ears that we would see Jesus. In Christ's name, amen. In the mid-1970s, houseboating was becoming a popular vacation option to many Americans. At the time, my parents were living in Denver, Colorado, and they had decided that they wanted to buy a timeshare on a houseboat on Lake Powell. And so there were actually a number of fellow workers where they were at, working at Porter Memorial Hospital in Denver, that decided the same. And they all went in together and they developed this timeshare for a houseboat on Lake Powell. And every summer for several years, even after my sisters and I got married, we enjoyed a journey to Lake Powell for a special time of fun in the sun. We found the grandeur of the barren sandstone cliffs to be absolutely incredible and awe-inspiring. And the clear blue water was refreshing on a 110-degree summer day. One year, we were camped 23 miles downriver from Bullfrog Marina. We needed some supplies, so Dad was going to take the ski boat up the river to the marina. We left the houseboat there parked at a camp place, and we got in the boat to head the 23 miles to Bullfrog Marina. And I decided that I wanted to go too, but I didn't want to go in the boat. I wanted to go behind the boat. I wanted to ski all 23 miles to the marina without stopping. Now, my dad thought I was crazy, especially since the only way to the marina was through the rough waters of the main channel of Lake Powell. And if any of you have ever been there before, you know what I'm talking about. There are literally hundreds of boats, anything from houseboats to huge ski boats, and people just chopping up the waters, and jet skis, and all kinds of stuff. And the water is just crazy rough. The boat traffic is absolutely horrific. But I was determined that I was going to do this. Now, folks, back in those days when I was in my early 20s, I was very trim, very fit, believe it or not. I was somewhat muscular, and I wanted to accept the challenge. I knew that my chances of making it all the way on one ski was pretty much impossible. I knew that it would just tire me way too much. So I put on two skis, and off I went on Lake Powell. After a mile of this stuff, I was beginning to wonder if I had made the right choice. But I kept plugging on. I was determined. 2 miles. 3 miles, 4 miles. After a while, my arms and legs began to ache, but I was determined. My dad did his best to find smoother waters along the canyon walls. But just about the time that I thought we had it good, some monster boat would come ripping by and churn everything up again. And I found myself fighting to stay up. But I was determined to make it all 23 miles without falling. 10 miles, 15 miles, So far, so good. But then we went through a place where the channel was narrow, with the canyon walls towering above us on either side, and the boat traffic was so intense and the waters were so rough that I felt like a cork in a washing machine on a heavy-duty cycle. How would I ever make it 23 miles without falling? But then I remembered something that my father had taught me when I was first learning to ski in my preteen years. He told me, "Son, when the water gets rough, bend your knees." I remember during the years that our family journeyed to Lake Powell for summer vacations, we also enjoyed cliff diving. We would find some nice sandstone overhang, and we'd love to jump in the water, sometimes 20, 30 feet above the water. I remember the first time that we tried it, my dad and mom gave my sisters and I this big lecture about making sure that we would check the water below and make sure there weren't any boulders or large objects in the water that we would somehow find unsafe. "You never know what's below the surface," Dad would say. "Make sure there are no large boulders under the water that you might hit. And no diving. And if you go head first from that high," Mom would say, "you're sure to break your neck." So as we stood at the top of the cliff, eyeing the water more than 300 inches below, we'd finally muster enough courage to jump, feet first. What a rush. I don't know about you, but I don't have to look very far out into the world today to know that we are in some pretty rough and uncertain waters. The economy, stock market, roller coaster ride. Just yesterday, the stock market finally inched above 17,000 for the first time in 2.5 months after it has taken numerous plunges. And what can we say about all the political grandstanding that's going on right now? Famines, wars, natural disasters around the globe. We don't know what's below the surface, and the water on the surface is so rough at times that it seems we're like a cork in a washing machine on the super spin cycle. And I guarantee you, friends, that it isn't getting any easier. In fact, in Revelation chapter 12, we read these words, "Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knows that he has what? But a short time." He's pulling out all the stops, friends. So how do we handle the chaos of life? Remembering what my dad told me about water skiing on rough waters. As we face the rough waters of life and the uncertainty of what's below the surface, we must do so, my friends, with our knees bent. Sometimes the waters of life are so rough that we forget that God has a plan for our lives. But let us be reminded of His words through Jeremiah the prophet, Jeremiah 29, verses 11 through 13, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." The reason why we don't find, friends, is because we're not spending any time seeking. But why is it that we don't spend time, more time, earnestly searching and seeking? Why is it that we don't spend more time on our knees? In Randy Maxwell's book, If My People Pray, he says, the problem with prayer is that too many people have come to view prayer as an exercise or a discipline. He says that prayer is neither an exercise nor a discipline. We need to view prayer as relationship. In other words, prayer is about our journey with Jesus. And it's not just personal prayer that's important. I want to repeat what I said. It's not just personal prayer that's important. It's not just having our personal devotional life. It's not just kneeling beside our bed before we go to bed and saying our prayers. In response to the question, why corporate prayer? Notice what Maxwell says in his book, If My People Pray. Why corporate prayer? It provides a release of power, a sense of unity, fellowship, and mutual encouragement. We're talking about the church family praying together. And when it comes to the importance of prayer, there's a story in John chapter 2 that gives us Christ's perspective. Let's notice. John chapter 2, verses 13 through 16. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" Jesus actually cleared the temple more than once. In fact, twice. Once at the beginning of his ministry and the other time at the end of his ministry. In fact, in Luke chapter 19 and verse 46, where Luke records the second cleansing of the temple by Jesus, he includes these words of Jesus recorded and quoted from Isaiah chapter 56 and verse 7. Notice what it says. It is written, this is Jesus speaking, it is written, my house will be a house of what? Prayer. But you have made it a den of robbers. You've made it a den of robbers. Jim Cimbala, the pastor of New York City's Brooklyn Tabernacle, in his book Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire, the chapter entitled The Day Jesus Got Mad, says this: the first century money changers were in the temple, but they didn't have the spirit of the temple. They may have played a legitimate role in assisting people to worship, but they were out of sync with the whole purpose of the Lord's house. Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer for who? All people. Let me ask you a question. How many of you believe that right now you're sitting in the house of the Lord? How many of you people believe that? You believe that? You believe you're sitting in the house of the Lord right now? Amen. We're in the house of the Lord. Cimbala says, the feature that is supposed to distinguish Christian people and Christian gatherings is the aroma of prayer. The house is not ours. It's the Father's. Then he goes on to ask, does the Bible ever say anywhere from Genesis to Revelation, my house shall be called a house of preaching? Does it ever say my house shall be called a house of music? We heard some wonderful music today. But the scripture does not call this place a house of music. The Bible does say this. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Preaching, music, the reading of the word, these things are fine. I believe in and practice all of them, says Cimbala. but they must never override prayer as the defining mark of God's dwelling. The honest truth is that I have seen God do more in people's lives during 10 minutes of real prayer than in 10 of my sermons. Notes Cymbala. Wow. Acts 1 reveals an interesting truth. The story of Acts tells the beginning of the Christian church, the movement of this new body of believers after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Jesus launched the Christian church not while someone was preaching. Jesus launched the Christian church not while someone was singing. He launched the Christian movement while His people were praying. In Acts chapter 1, verses 12 through 14, it says, "Then they returned to Jerusalem," that is, the followers of Jesus, "from the hill called the Mount of Olives." Jesus had just ascended into heaven. And so they returned to Jerusalem. It says, "They went upstairs to the room where they were staying. They all joined together constantly in what? In prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with His brothers." This group came together after the ascension of Jesus into heaven. They came together to pray. And Acts chapter 4 and verse 31 says, "After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly." Cymbala, with more than 30 years of ministry in New York City, notes that more people are turning to crack than to Christ. More people are dipping into drugs than are getting baptized in water. What is going to reverse this tide? Cymbala asks. Preaching alone will not do it. Classes aren't going to do it. More money for more programs won't do it. Only turning God's house into a house of fervent prayer will reverse the power of evil. Do you believe that? Again in his book, If My People Pray, Randy Maxwell says, "We are not here merely to sing songs, nod off during the sermons, haggle over religious trivia, complete a tithe envelope, and wait for Jesus to beam us up. Have you ever noticed how churches tend to gravitate to the latest methodology, the latest seminar, the latest worship technique as some kind of panacea for the church, some cure-all? It's going to make the church grow. Fact of the matter is that Jesus made the solution abundantly clear when He said, "My house will be a house of prayer for who? All people." John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, Jesus said, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father, and whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." The problem is, according to James chapter 4 and verse 2, you do not have because you do not ask God. Friends, we don't spend enough time asking God. We don't spend enough time praying to God. We don't spend enough time on our knees. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 7, Jesus made it plain. He says, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened." I've been your pastor now for over 4 years. And I believe now more than ever, if our church is to be successful in this journey of the unknown, we must do so with our knees bent. I'm not talking about the posture, friends. I'm talking about the attitude. If we as a church are going to reach this community for Christ, we must do it on our knees. Why? Because Jesus said, "My house will be a house of prayer for what? All people." And friends, that includes the Simi Valley Seventh-day Adventist Church. Do you believe it? There's a story that I love from the Scriptures. I tend to like stories that have neat endings. And while at times the story from Genesis to Revelation has some bad twists and turns to it, all we have to do is take a look at the back of the book and we find out that Jesus wins. And that's some pretty good news. But there's a story in Scripture that starts out rather dismal, bleak. It's a story of Job. Most of you are familiar with it. Job was a very wealthy man. He had more than enough. He had countless herds of cattle and sheep and goats and donkeys, camels. He had myriads of houses. He had a number of children. I think it was 10 children. He had all kinds of maidservants and male servants. And Job was a very, very wealthy man for his day, for his time. Do you remember how the story goes? Devil came to God and said, "Listen, Job only serves you because you take care of him. You know, wipe him out, take everything away, and he'll curse your face and he'll die." And as the story unfolds, Job loses everything he owns. His houses, his land, his children. Everything. His herds. His wife. And a couple of his friends come, and I say friends somewhat in quotes, and they mock him. And they tell him, "Hey, listen, man, you must have offended God." And this dialogue goes on throughout the book of Job. And Job, his wife, tells him, "Hey, listen, why don't you just curse God and die?" And he says to her, "Listen, though he slay me, yet will I trust him." And his friends keep coming and saying, "Hey, man, something isn't right with your life." To use the vernacular that I learned when I lived in the South, his friends came to him and said, "Hey, Job, you ain't right." And they mocked him and told him that he needed to get right with God. And then we come to Job chapter 42, the very last chapter of the book of Job. And I would invite you to open your Bibles there, Job 42, and beginning with verse 7. There's something very interesting that's unfolding here. As Job's friends have been mocking him and giving him a bad time. And notice what happens now, beginning verse 7. And it says, "And so it was, after the Lord had spoken these words to Job," he has this conversation with Job, "that the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, 'My wrath is aroused against you and your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has.' Now therefore," verse 9, "8, take for yourselves 7 bulls and 7 rams, go to my servant Job and offer up for yourself a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you, for I will accept him, lest I deal with you according to your folly, because you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has." So Eliphaz the Temanite and Bildad the Shuhite and Zophar the Naamathite went and did as the Lord commanded them, for the Lord had accepted Job. So God said, "Hey, listen, go to Job, take a sacrifice, and have him pray for you. Have him pray for you." Now here's this man Job, still at total loss. The man doesn't have anything to his name, and now, more than ever, would be an opportunity for Job to bemoan his life circumstances. "Look, man, I've lost my fortune, I've lost everything I have." But what does Job do? Job responds to the challenge when these men come and say, pray for us. God has said, we need you to pray for us. And notice what happens in verse 10. And the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Wow. Friends, I'm not trying to preach prosperity theology, but the equation is simple. When Job responded to the challenge that was given by God, hey, to these guys, go and have Job pray for you. And Job did so. It says that the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends, and he gave him twice what he had before. The story of Job ends and tells about the fact that his daughters were more beautiful, his new daughters that he had were more beautiful than any other women in the land. And Job had countless riches, and he was taken care of, and God prospered him more than he had before. And we can turn as a church and we can look and say, some of us who have been part of this congregation for 30 and 40 years, and we can turn around and we can say, hey, I remember the days when this church was packed out, when it was full, when you couldn't find a place to park when you came to church, and now, you know, you can have a pew to yourself. But listen, friends, I believe that God can prosper us again and give us twice what we had before. Amen? And what is the key to making sure that's going to happen? To do exactly what Job did. To not spend time bemoaning our losses. To not spend time feeling sorry for ourselves and licking our wounds. But to get down on our knees and to pray for our friends. To pray for our family. To pray for our community. To pray for Simi Valley. And I believe that God will do something powerful. What would happen if we spent more time as a church family praying for each other and less time talking about each other? Do you think God would restore our losses? Do you think the Lord would prosper this church like never before? I believe so. In the book Steps to Christ, we find these words: prayer is the opening of the heart to God as a friend. Not that it is necessary in order to make known to God what we are, but in order to enable us to receive Him. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but brings us up to Him. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14, we find these great words from the Lord: if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. What would happen if we as a church family would come together and pray for our friends and our family and for this city? I want to tell you that I have been spending significant time praying about how we can make that happen. Many of you know that for the last 3+ years that Pastor Jan and I have had a Wednesday evening prayer and study group, fellowship group meeting in our home. We've had a number of people come. We have had anywhere from 6 to 8 people to as many as 15 people show up on a Wednesday evening. We've had a great time. There have been many lives that have been changed. And I'm going to invite Vicki, you and Kathy Malhotra, come and join me here. And I had a microphone up here, but somewhere it disappeared. So make sure we get a mic here. There have been many lives that have been changed as a result of what's going on. I'm looking out here and I can see some of you. Kate, you and Dave became a part of the Adventist family because of that small group, didn't you? It was through the prayer and the study time, and it changed your lives. And I know the two of you have been coming for the last several months, and you know, both of you have been part of the family for a long time. I'd just like for you to take a minute and share Vicki, what has this done for you? You come every Wednesday night. You've been faithful. You've been committed. It's only been on a rare occasion that you've missed. But tell me, what does Wednesday night mean to you as you come together for that fellowship and that prayer time and that study time?
It's amazing to look forward so much to Wednesday evenings so that I can be with family, with people I love, with people who love me, with people who know me, who want to know me, and who, as we're in a small group and we study God's Word and we have Bible study. I've had Bible studies, many Bible studies in the past, but this one's different. This one, it opens your heart to not only God and His Word, but to each other. And that has an amazing effect on all of us.
Kathy, what about you? What has it meant to your life?
I was really surprised because I, first of all, felt a need that God put on my heart. And so I just said, yes, okay, I'm going to go find any Bible study group that I can get into. And Rose invited me to your house, and I came. And so first of all, the meaning for me was just obedience to God. And then second of all, I can tell you that since I've been in this prayer group, so many things have changed in my life. I could document what's happened.
And answers to prayer.
Yeah, you know, and it's like another level of His leading in my life, and it's crossed all the areas of my life. So my field, my finances, my family, my friends, my clients, it just goes on. And if you don't mind, I just want to tell you a story. It's a really short one that I heard recently, and it really coincided with a study on the Hebrews that we're doing too. And it was two American Indians, and the grandfather says to the grandson, inside of each person, there are two horses fighting each other. And one horse is destructive and evil and does evil things, and the other horse is a good horse that is kind and generous and thoughtful and courageous. And so the son says to the grandfather, well, Grandpa, which one wins? And the grandfather says, whichever one you feed. And that was brought out in Hebrews too. So, you know, we have to feed the right horse and let it win. Otherwise, there's no stagnation. The other horse wins.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, ladies. Thank you for your testimony. And it's been wonderful as Pastor Jan and I have opened our home and we've seen people's lives impacted and changed. But you know, I've been doing a lot of thinking and praying. Pastor Jan and I have been talking about this, and we've been praying about what God would have us do. And we've been praying in our group, how can we encourage more people to experience this in the body of Christ? How can we make Simi Valley Church a house of prayer for all people? And so with that in mind, we have ceased doing the format in our home, and we've decided to start that and open it up church-wide right here at our church. And, you know, you've heard of IHOP. Many of you have gone to eat at IHOP. Well, we're going to start a new hop here in the church. But it's not going to be the house of pancakes. It's going to be the house of prayer. In fact, we're going to call it Simi Hop. And we, as a church family, are going to begin a house of prayer ministry, and we are going to come together as God's people to pray. Amen?
Amen?
And I want to make a heartfelt appeal for you to make Wednesday night a priority. Friends, this isn't just an ordinary prayer meeting. I've tried prayer meetings before, and they kind of flop. I'm going to tell you some of what we're going to do. And we don't expect people to come to everything. We don't expect people to make that commitment to come to everything. Some of you will be able to do that. Some of you simply can't do that, and that's understandable. We're going to start every Wednesday evening, 5:30 in the campus center, from 5:30 to 6:30. We're going to serve supper from 5:30 to 6:30, kind of like we do during our week of renewal and revival, a time of fellowship and a time of eating together. Then at 6:30, we're moving here into the sanctuary, and we're going to have our hour of prayer. And some of you might say, well, how can we pray for an hour? We're going to create a worshipful atmosphere in here. There's going to be some music. There's going to be a time of testimony. And for those of you who don't feel comfortable praying in a group, there's going to be opportunities for you to pray by yourself. But we are going to come together, and we are going to make this church, by God's grace, what He has asked us to make it, a house of what? Prayer. Amen. For all people. And it will only be as successful as you make it. And then at 6:30, I'm sorry, at 7:30, those who wish to stay will go back into the campus center, and we will have a one-hour Bible study in the campus center. There are some of you that have friends that you are wanting to study the Bible with. Come. We're going to mentor you, and we're going to show you how to give a personal Bible study and how we can get into God's Word and how we can make it come alive and see the good news in God's Word, how we can let the gospel of Jesus Christ live and breathe in us. And I invite you to do that. So, for those of you that want to commit, it's 3 hours. Those of you that can't, you may come for supper and say, hey, I'm just coming in for supper and I'm going to be praying with you, praying for you on my way home. If that's it, so be it. Come in fellowship. If you can only come at 6:30 and pray for that 1 hour time and you have to leave, whatever. But this is an opportunity for us to come together as the family of God. And you want to know what? Our focus is going to be reaching this community for Christ. There are people that there are things that we're doing right now. There are people we're reaching out to through the Simi Fit program. We need to make that a matter of serious prayer, because those people need to be introduced not just to healthful living so that they live to be 80, 90, and 100, but to introduce to Jesus so they can live forever and ever. That needs to be our goal, and that needs to be our mission, and that will only happen on our knees. And so I'm asking you, friends, will you prayerfully commit to coming this Wednesday evening, 5:30, supper in the campus center? If you can't join us at 5:30, join us at 6:30 for the prayer time. If you can't join us for 6:30, come 7:30 for the study time. But come. I challenge you to come. Put it on your calendars. Come this Wednesday night. Nothing can be more important. Friends, we have to quit playing with time. We have to get on our knees. And so I prayerfully ask you to commit your time to this ministry and make this church a house of prayer. I love this quote from the book Steps to Christ. Prayer is the key in the hand of faith to unlock heaven's storehouse, where are treasured the boundless resources of omnipotence. God has boundless resources, and we haven't even taken time to tap into them. We can do it on our knees. God is calling us to reach those boundless resources of omnipotence. I knew how far I had come by the mile markers in the channel. The numbers were painted on the buoys there. Eighteen, 19, 20 miles, and I was still on my skis. Amazingly, I hadn't taken one single spill. The waves of Lake Powell were mountainous, and my body felt like a piece of hamburger that just came through a meat grinder. But I was determined. Several times my dad would motion to me, asking me if I wanted to stop. But I kept pointing on. At mile marker 21, we broke out into the bay that leads to Bullfrog Marina. And I could see it in the distance. Could I hold on? Would I be able to make it all 23 miles? Bullfrog Marina was now clearly in sight when I saw mile marker 23. And the next buoy I saw said, no wake zone. My dad cut the throttle, and I let go of the rope. I had made it. My arms remained bent out, straight in front of me, like a real estate yard arm sign. I could not even bring them to my side. My knees were bent to the point that I thought I would waddle the rest of my life, and maybe that's my problem today. My dad drug my half-paralyzed body into the boat. But I had made it through the rough waters of Lake Powell. On bended knees. Friends, on the journey of life, the waters are rough and uncertain. At times we may wonder whether we'll make it safely to the marina. But I can see, my friends, that great marina in the distance. Can we hold on? We need to do it together on our knees. Our journey is almost over. Yes, my friends, we can do it. We can do it on our knees. Last Sabbath, those of you who are here, heard Allie sing a beautiful song for special music, On My Knees. When I heard it, I went to her afterwards and I said, Allie, got to have a repeat performance. That is the perfect appeal song. Please listen to the words as she sings it once again, On My Knees.
There are days when I feel the best of me is ready to begin. And the days when I feel I'm letting go, I'm soaring on the wind. 'Cause I've learned in laughter or in pain how to survive. I get on my knees. There I am before the love that changes me. See, I don't know how, but there's power when I'm on my knees. I can be in a crowd or by myself, almost anywhere. When I feel there's a need to talk with God, He is Emmanuel. When I close my eyes, no darkness there, there's only light. I get on my knees. I get on my knees. There I am before the love that changes me. Still, I don't know how, but there's power in the blue skies, in the midnight, when I'm on my knees. I get on my knees. I get on my knees. There I am before the love that changes me. See, I don't know how, but this power when I'm on my, oh, when I'm on my, when I'm on my knees.
Amen. You ready to get on your knees? Let's do it as a church family. Let's get on our knees and let's see God restore our losses. Let's see Him do something in this body of believers and in our lives that He is longing and waiting to do. Let's get on our knees. Let's pray. Oh, Father God, we come to You today on our knees. We come to You today pleading, recognizing our need for You. We've got to quit messing around, Lord. We believe that Your coming is very soon, and there are people in this community, friends, family, loved ones, that desperately need to know the good news about Jesus. As we face the rough, uncertain waters of life all around us, we come to You on our knees. As we launch this new house of prayer ministry, Lord, do something incredibly powerful in our lives and in this body of believers to advance Your kingdom until at last we do see You face to face and know that we are safely home. May that day be soon, we ask and pray in Christ's name. Amen.